பேராலயம் வணங்கும் 40 நாட்கள் உபவாச தொடர் சங்கிலி ஜபம் நாள் ஜூலை 7 முதல் ஆகஸ்ட் 15 வரை நம்முடைய திருச்சபையில் 24 மணி நேரமும் தொடர் சங்கிலி ஜபம் நடைபெற்று கொண்டிருக்கிறது. தேசத்திற்காக, சபைகளுக்காக, குடும்பங்களுக்காக, குடும்பங்களுடைய எழுப்புதலுக்காக, ஆசீர்வாதத்திற்காக, வேலைகளுக்காக, பிள்ளைகள் கல்வி மற்றும் எதிர்காலத்திற்காகவும் ஜெபித்து கொண்டு வருகிறோம். இந்த ஜெபத்தில் கலந்து கொண்டு ஜெபித்து ஆசீர்வாதங்களையும் விடுதலையையும் சுகத்தையும் நன்மையையும் பெற்றுக்கொள்ள அனைவரையும் அன்புடன் அழைக்கிறோம். மேலும் விவரங்களை அறிந்து கொள்ள உங்கள் ஏரியா போதகர்களை தொடர்பு கொள்ளவும். மேலும் மாலை 6:30 மணி முதல் 8 மணி வரை யூடியூப் வாயிலாக தலைமை போதகருடைய எழுப்புதல் நிறைந்த செய்தியையும் அக்கினி மயமான ஜெபத்திலும் கலந்து கொள்ள அன்புடன் அழைக்கிறோம். வாருங்கள், ஜெபித்திடுங்கள், தேசத்தில் மாற்றத்தை கண்டிடுங்கள்.
Thank you. Praise the Lord, church. Good morning. Happy to see you all, and we welcome you for the Sunday service live. Amen. How many of you are happy this morning? Shout out and amen. Amen. God is faithful in all the ways. Amen. Let's just pray and start the service. Heavenly Father God, thank you for this wonderful morning which you've given, Lord. Lord, we praise your name, Jesus. Lord, you are our Abba Father. You are the one whom we can cling on to, Jesus. Lord, your ways are way beyond our description of, Father God. Lord, thank you for helping us in this difficult situation also, Father God. Lord, we know that you are the one who helps us, O Father. Lord, thank you for giving us good health and strength, O Father. Lord, thank you for protecting us in each and every way, O Father God. Lord, we have trust in you and we hope you, Father God. We have hope in you, Jesus. You are the wonderful God whom we serve, Father. Lord, thank you for choosing us as children, O Father God. Lord, let us glorify your name on high, O Father. Lord, we give everything which is going to happen this moment, O Father God. Lord, we give this day into your hands, O Father God. You take and you have complete control of, Father God. We give into everything into your hands, Jesus. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. 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 Join us as we sing. Sing, sing, sing. I'll make music with the heaven. We will sing, sing, sing. The grateful that you hear us when we shout your praise. Lift high the name of Jesus. What's not to love about you? Heaven and earth adore you. Kings and kingdoms bow down. Son of God, you are the one. You are the one. You are the love that frees us. You are the light that leads us. Like a fire burning. Son of God, you are the one. You are the one we're living for. Sing, sing, sing. I'll make music with the heavens. We will sing, sing, sing. The grateful that you hear us when we shout your praise. Live high, O flame of Jesus. We will sing, sing, sing. I'll make music with the heavens. We will sing, sing, sing. The grateful that you hear us when we shout your praise. Live high the name of Jesus. What's not to love about you? Heaven and earth adore you. Kings and kingdoms bow down. Son of God, you are the one. You are the one we're living for. Sing, sing, sing. I'll make music for the heaven. We will sing, sing, sing. The grateful that you hear us when we shout. Live high the name of Jesus. We will sing, sing, sing. I'll make music with the heaven. We will sing, sing, sing. Be grateful that you hear us when we shout your praise. Live high. Praise your name, Lord Jesus. We will sing, sing, sing. I'll make music with the heaven. We will sing, sing, sing. We're grateful that you hear us when we shout your praise. Lift high the name of Jesus. Everybody join us as we sing. We will sing, sing, sing. And make music with a hammer. We will sing, sing, sing. The grateful that you hear us when we shout your praise. Live high the name of Jesus. Cast your burden unto Jesus, for He cares for you. Cast your burden unto Jesus, for He cares for you. Cast your burden unto Jesus, for He cares for you. Cast your burden unto Jesus, for He cares for you. Jesus, for He cares for you. Cast your burdens unto Jesus, for He cares for you. Higher, 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 lift Jesus higher. Higher, 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 lift Jesus lower. Lower, 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 lower. Satan lower, 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 stop Satan lower, 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 stop, 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 higher, higher.
Lord, these are my problems, these are my burdens. You got a statement with faith that God's going to do wonderful things. Amen.
Higher, 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 lift Jesus higher. Higher, 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 lift Jesus higher. Cast your burden unto Jesus, for He cares for you. Cast your burden unto Jesus, for He cares for you. Everyone sing higher, 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 lift Jesus higher. Higher, 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 lift Jesus higher. Lower, 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 stop Satan lower. Lower, 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 stop Satan lower. Lower, 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 stop Satan lower. Lower, 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 stop, 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 stop. Higher, 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 lift Jesus higher. Higher, 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 lift Jesus higher. Higher.
praise your name, Jesus.
Praise is rising, eyes are turning to you. We turn to you. Hope is stirring, hearts are yearning for you. We long for you. Cause when we see you, we find strength, face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away. Name, Lord Jesus. Amen, amen, amen. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Psalm 91, verse 5, it says, "You will not fear the terror of night, nor the arrow that flies by the day." In Psalm 18, verse 28, it says, "Keep my lamp burning. My God turns my darkness into light." On Psalm 28, verse 7, it says, "The Lord is my shepherd and my shield. My heart trusts in Him, and He helps me. My heart leaps with joy, and with my song I praise Him." Amen. How many of you say, "In midst of darkness, God has given me light"? Amen. Many of us can testify what God has done in our life. Let us sing praises to Jesus' name. Join us as we sing. Let's worship Jesus.
The darkness flies the night, it cannot hide the light. Whom shall I fear? You crush the enemy underneath my feet. You are my sword and shield, don't trouble linger still. Whom shall I fear? Before me, I know who stands behind. The God of angel army is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, He is the friend of mine. The God of angel army is always by my side. Is in your name, for you alone can save. You will tell even me, yours is the victory. Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I fear? I know who goes before me, I know who stands. Always by my side, the one who reigns forever, He is the friend of mine. The God of angel army is always by my side. I know who goes before me, I know who stands behind. The God of angel army is always by my side. I'm one who He is the friend of mine. The God of angel army is always by my side. And nothing formed against me shall stand. You hold the whole world in your hand. I'm holding on to your promises. You are before me. I know who stands behind. The God of angel army is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, he is the friend of mine. The God of angel army is always by my side. I know who goes before me. I know who stands behind. The God of angel army is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, he is the friend of mine. The God of angel army is always by my side. The God of angel army is always by my side. And nothing formed against me shall stand. You hold the whole world in your hand. I'm holding on to your promises. You are faithful. You are faithful. Against me shall stand. You hold the whole world in your hand. I'm holding on to your promises. You are faithful. You are faithful. You are faithful.
You are great, Lord. You are a great King, Jesus. We worship your name, Lord.
You give life, young God. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. Pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only. Great are you, Lord. You give life, you are love, you bring
you, Lord.
All the earth
earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones they sing. Great are you, Lord. And all the earth will shout your praise. My heart will cry, these bones will sing.
Still you gave yourself away. Whoa.
raise your hands and sing. I couldn't earn it, I don't deserve it, still you gave yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you for your love. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for this wonderful worship which you've given us, Lord. Oh, thank you for this wonderful time of worship which we had in this place, Father.
Lord, we know that you are in our midst, Father. Thank you for your Holy Spirit, Lord. Lord, thank you for your abundant grace and abundant love and abundant everything, O Father. Lord, we pray and give entire things into your hands, O Jesus. You take complete control, O Father God. Lord, we submit before your throne. You take complete control, O Jesus. We give everything into your hands, Lord. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen, amen, amen.
Good morning and a very warm welcome to our online English service here at Bethel City Cathedral. We are so glad that you're joining us today, and we pray for God's richest blessing upon your life as you gather with us today in honoring God. I hope that you were strengthened and encouraged in our time of worship. Especially, maybe you're viewing us for the first time. I want to say a very special welcome to you. We're so delighted to have you with us. Please let us know if there's anything that we can pray for you or encourage you with as you're going through the different situations in your life. Now, the Bible reminds us that we need to bless the Lord at all times. Let His praise continually be upon our lips. Now, are you finding yourself, talking negative about everything? Or are you finding yourself talking about God's goodness and God's blessings? Can I encourage you today to focus your attention on the goodness of God, on the greatness of God? So today, instead of, talking about how, things are not working out or how that's not coming together, why don't you change the way you speak and say, God is good. And all the time, God is good. And as you begin declaring the praises of God, there's something that happens in our circumstance, in our situation as well. And I want to encourage you to begin declaring the words of God and the promises of God. This week, our nation celebrates its Independence Day. It's a very special week because we kind of remember the incredible freedom we have as an Indian to be able to live in one of the largest democracies in the world. And there's still a lot of ambiguity about whether it's the 73rd or 74th Independence Day. I think it has to do with, whether we're completing 73 years and beginning 74 years. There's always people, we're talking about birthdays and they never know how old they are. But in any case, I want to tell you, we have a reason to pray for the blessing of our nation. More than any other time of this year, as we celebrate our Independence Day this week, I think we need to take a moment and bless the nation of India. Bless the leaders of the nation of India. And bless the people who live in this amazing country. That God will prosper it. God will change the situation. God will bring an end to this pandemic. And God will bring His healing and blessing upon our land as well. Would you join me in just a moment? Wherever you are, lift up your hand with me and say, Lord, I bless the nation of India today. We pray a blessing over the leaders of our nation, the Prime Minister, the Chief Minister, all those who are in governmental positions over our nation. Lord, we bless them and we pray that your grace will be upon them. Lord, give them wisdom to continue to lead our nation in the right way. Lord, bless the nation of India. And we ask, Lord, that you will change the situation in this pandemic, that you will give healing to this land, and you will give deliverance to our people, that we will come into a new season of your blessing and your favor, Lord God. As your children today, we speak blessing over the city of Coimbatore, over the leadership of the city of Coimbatore. Give wisdom to those who are in governance as well. Lord, we seek your face and your incredible favor upon our nation and upon our city. Bless your people, bless businesses, bless companies, bless the different people who are working in our city, O God, and help their businesses to be revived, help their businesses to continue to grow. And we speak your grace in the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen, amen, amen. Well, we're so glad you're with us, and we're going to hear exhortation from Brother Tapan about giving and also announcements about what's happening this week. Just to remind you, we're in the last leg of our 40 days of revival prayer. We've been having a fantastic time every evening from 6:30 to about 8:30, where we've had some amazing times of prayer and exhortation as well. If you've missed it, I tell you, this last week, the last 7 days, do not miss the wonderful time of prayer. Tonight, at 6:30. Come join us for a powerful time of prayer and waiting on the Lord for revival. Be blessed. Here's Brother Tapa.
Good morning, all. I thank God this morning for this opportunity to stand before you all towards giving. We have taken today's verse from the book of Proverbs, chapter 3, verse 9 and 10, which says, "Honor the Lord with your wealth, with the best part of everything you produce." Then verse says, verse 10, "Then he will fill you, your barn with grain and your vats with overflow good wine." This also reminds me, Matthew chapter 6, verse 33, which says, "Seek you God's kingdom first and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you." Now, this verse itself is a self-explanatory, but I want to bring some of the highlights. Honor means to give respect. Especially this proverb encourages us to honor the Lord. Give him first place and all the respect. When you see the word Lord in capital letter, it is the English translation for Yahweh. When we understand and accept who God is, then we are to honor him with our best and finest wealth. God's existence is the most important factor in honoring Lord with our wealth. And when we do this by giving our best for the kingdom of God, God blesses his people with best in everything. He will guide us. He will give good wisdom and knowledge in your business, in your job, wherever you are working for, to excel. One more very important thing which I want to mention is giving the Lord leftover when large or small is not called honor, and it does not fulfill the proverb. King Solomon gave a financial secret. First fruit giving is called to honor the God. So here finally I can say, if you give cheerfully, liberally, generously, God will definitely bless you greatly and richly in your life. So let us pray and give our offering. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for this wonderful day you have blessed us. We thank you for your presence in our life, O Lord Jesus. Lord, we pray for each and every one, those who are giving towards the kingdom of God, O Lord. Those who are giving their best and honoring you through their finance, O Lord Jesus. Lord, we pray for their more blessings in life, O Lord. We want to see many breakthrough in finance in their life, O Lord Jesus. Lord, we want to hear many good testimonies from them, glorifying your name alone, O Lord Jesus. Today, whatever we have, everything comes from you, O Lord. We give you honor and glory. In the wonderful, precious Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I have few announcements this morning. The first one which really encourages me also, that we have teen service every Sunday at 5 p.m. in the evening. I will request parents, please encourage your children to attend. Second one, 40 days revival prayer is happening every day at 6:30 p.m. through Zoom and YouTube. Be a part of prayer and be blessed. We also have Build Professional Fellowship, which is going to be held on 16th August at 12:30 p.m. on Sunday. The theme will be the story of insects. So I will request all professionals to join this through Zoom and be encouraged. Fourth one, lunch and learn program, which we always have on second Sunday of the month. This month we have postponed to 23rd August at 12:30 p.m. through Zoom. All couples are requested to join and be encouraged. You can learn many good things and develop your qualities to have a good and joyful life. The fifth one and the last, we will also have R&D fellowship for youngsters on 30th August at 12:30 p.m. through Zoom. For any further details about these events, kindly contact our serving team leaders and LG leaders. And I can say that you can see through the display screen about more details. Thank you and God bless you all.
I know you make a way. I don't always understand, I don't always get to see, but I will believe it, I will believe it. 'Cause you make mountains move, you make giants fall, and you use songs of praise to shake prison walls. And I will speak to my fear, I will preach to my doubt, that you were faithful then, you'll be faithful now. I am standing on
that I hear often in my home these days from my four-year-old daughter is, "Daddy, I am bored." She walks around, throwing herself on the couch, breathes heavily, and says, "Daddy, I am very bored." I understand her frustration. Even as adults, most of us are at a place right now in our life where we're ready to move on. Many of us have questions as, you know, when will the vaccine be ready? When will all of this end? When can we resume our normal lives? If there is one thing we have all been forced to learn in 2020, it is the art of waiting or patience. You know, we have a new understanding of how little control we have over our own life. Even governments are recognizing that they can't control everything. We've heard many politicians literally lift their hands up in the air and say, you know, it's all in God's hands. And I cannot think of a more truer statement than that. Sometimes we can become so focused for things to change, we fail to appreciate the moment that we are in right now. When all this is over, there's a good chance that many of us would reminisce and we will say, oh, remember those lockdown days, how much time we had. You know, remember those lockdown days and how horrible and terrible it was. Whether it is a good time for you or a bad time for you, I would say it still serves a vital purpose in the building of our character and our life as well. The Word of God reminds us in the book of James, chapter 1, verse 2, it says, count it all joy when you fall into various trials and temptations. In other words, God's Word reminds us that we are to enjoy and be grateful for the season of life that we are in right now. If you're unmarried, enjoy your singleness. If you are married, enjoy your spouse. If you have children who are stuck at home with you because they can't go to school, enjoy the time that you have with having your children in your home. Because you may never get an opportunity like this, and your children are never going to be exactly what they are right now. Many of us, instead of enjoying the moment we are in, we're either looking forward for it to change, or we're looking backward to the times that we used to enjoy and we reminisce as well. In doing that, we actually miss the valuable things that God wants to teach us and show us in the midst of our situation. You know, the Bible says in Psalm 118, verse 24, and we all know the scripture, it says, this is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. The Bible doesn't say tomorrow is the day the Lord will make, or yesterday is the day that the Lord had made. It says today is the day the Lord has made. Rejoice and be glad in it. So the Word of God teaches us to enjoy the moment that we are in right now and to be grateful and to give thanks to God for the things that have been allowed in our life at this very moment, whether it be good or bad as well. Now, we've all been following the life of Joseph for the past 2 weeks. And Joseph, I would say, is very familiar with bad seasons. He endured many seasons in life where nothing was going the way that he thought it would go. Sitting in prison, forgotten by the one man who actually had the ability to help with Joseph's freedom. You know, the dream that he had had as a teenager probably seemed very distant to him and unreal and impossible. And he had hoped that his life would have turned out pretty successful considering he was the most favorite son of his father. And yet, here he was, sitting in prison and rotting away, forgotten by people, forgotten by the person who could have actually helped brought about his deliverance. I would say Joseph had a Job-like nature. The way that he responded to his situation, you know, Job also never lost hope, you know, and Joseph, in all circumstances and seasons of his life, he never loses hope for what was about to happen or what could come about as well. And I would say Joseph did not get bitter with God, nor did he get bitter about people who were probably the reason why he found himself where he was. You know, he always was a guy who saw the glass half full. And I think, you know, according to the Bible, in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 23, the Bible says, let us hold tightly without wavering to the hope that we affirm, for God can be trusted to keep his promise. And this was what Joseph was living in his life. He was holding on to the hope that God could be trusted to keep his promise in the life of Joseph. And are your dreams being delayed? Now, the things that you had hoped would happen have not happened yet. Do you feel helpless in your situation? Are you confused and discouraged about your future? I would say the life of Joseph stands as a shining light for every single one of us to learn from as someone who thrived in uncertain times. He did not just survive, he thrived during times of great difficulty as well. And I would say we can learn some valuable lessons from the life of Joseph. You know, to begin with, he did not allow his circumstances to overcome him. Rather, he always overcame whatever circumstance he was put into as well. He did not wither away in the waiting. He actually grew stronger in the waiting. You don't have to weaken during your waiting. You can grow and become strong in your time of waiting as you follow the example of Joseph. I would say, let your waiting time not become wasted time. Why? Because God desires to prepare you and me through the seasons of our life for what is about to come. The one amazing hope that we have is, if your situation is terrible and the greater difficulty that you're facing, the greater joy you need to have, because the greater preparation that God is doing for what he is about to release and bring you into your life as well. We need to allow God to do the work that needs to be done in our lives during the season of waiting as well. You know, in the car races, you know, some of us are big fans of, you know, watching races. And I would say the pinnacle of all car races is the F1 championship, or Formula One, as many people would call it. And in Formula One, if you're someone who watches that sport, you'd be very familiar with the term pit stop. And basically, you know, you could have a driver who and his car be in the lead position of the race. But at the moment the race engineer decides that the car needs to come in for a pit stop, it doesn't matter where this car is in the position of the race winning, the moment the race engineer says it's time for a pit stop, the driver brings the car into the pit stop. Even though the pit stop only takes a matter of a few seconds, by the time the driver gets back on the track, he would have lost his lead position, sometimes from first position to eighth position, or even 10th or 15th position. You know, so by the time he comes out, you know, he's lost the incredible edge that he had over other racers. Now, as a viewer who is sitting and watching this race, you could think, man, how horrible is that? What a waste of time this pit stop has been. This guy who is at the front of the race because he's been asked to come in for a pit stop now finds himself at the back of the race. Now, I would say when you understand what the pit stop is all about and what it does to the racer and the car, you begin to understand the absolute need for a pit stop. So basically what happens in a pit stop in basically a few seconds is, and as soon as the car pulls into the pit stop lane, there's a whole team of people who literally jack up the car, change the tires, check everything is right on the car. You know, the driver gets to drink some precious water, rehydrate himself. The car is recalibrated, and then within seconds, the car is launched out. So when the car comes back on the track, the car is stronger. The car is better equipped to continue to race as well. There is a better work that is done within the car, and even the driver is refreshed to be able to continue with the racing as well. So when you begin to realize how much good a pit stop does for a racer, you realize even in life, when we are sometimes sidelined, when sometimes we're put on the bench and you feel like everyone is passing you by and everyone else is being successful, everyone is achieving their dreams and everyone's doing what they had hoped to do, and here you are sitting on the sidelines and watching other people do great things, you got to remind yourself there is a great work that is being done in your life. And the work that God does in your life is very precious, because he knows the distance that you have to travel, and he knows what needs to be done in your life, in your character, in the different aspects of your life to prepare you to be able to finish your race well. Come on, someone, you know, encourage yourself today, especially if you find yourself in a place of waiting, in a place where you are sidelined. Don't get discouraged. Don't allow your life, you know, what you're experiencing right now to begin to make you feel like you're losing out on some amazing things. You are someone who has been called by God, and God has a great plan for your life, and God is working a precious work in your life. In your waiting, God is doing something amazing, and when God is done his work in your life, you're going to come out stronger, you're going to come out more refined, you're going to come out with better abilities and better understanding on the things that God wants to do. And I love the scripture in Isaiah chapter 40 verse 31. All of us know the scripture, and that's the scripture you need to hold on to, which says, but those who wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles, and they shall run and not be weary, and they shall walk and not faint. That's the promise you got to hold on to. You got to tell yourself, the more I wait, the more I'm staying in standstill motion, the stronger I'm becoming, the greater work that God is doing in my life. And when God is done with what he's doing in my life, I'm going to come out shooting out of the gate, and I'm going to accomplish and fulfill the plans and the purpose that God has for my life as well. Joseph knew all about waiting. You know, we read his story in a matter of few minutes. But what we sometimes fail to understand is it took Joseph a lifetime to live that life. You know, you just read that sentence and he says, oh, Joseph was thrown in a pit and he was sold to the Midianite traders. You know, it would have taken Joseph a greater part of 30 days from the time that he was in the pit being sold to the Midianite traders to be actually taken to Egypt. Those 30 days, what was he thinking about? What was going on in his mind? And when he is sold from the Midianites to an Egyptian, you know, a guy in Egypt, you know, and Joseph works in Potiphar's house. It was not just a matter of a few months he worked at. He actually worked there for 10 years. Joseph slaved away in Potiphar's house, starting from the lowest rank and working his way up to be a man of influence and position of authority. It took him 10 years, and within a matter of few minutes and seconds, all of the hard work of 10 years crumbled away in just an instant. What would have gone through his mind as he sat in prison? What was he thinking about in those seasons of setbacks in his life where he had done things that every good person does? He had done things where every righteous person does, and yet every single time he thinks he's making progress, he's slapped in the face and put 10 steps back. You know, what was going on in the mind of Joseph in the seasons of waiting? And I would tell you that probably Joseph is one of the most amazing personalities in the Bible from whom we can learn the art of waiting. And that's what I want to talk about this morning, because there are many of us who are in this season of waiting. You're waiting for your situation to change. You're waiting to get married. You're waiting to get a job. You're waiting to make money. You're waiting for your life to move on. You're waiting for children. You're waiting for this. All of us find ourselves in some place or season in our life of waiting. And while you are waiting, what do you do? As a child of God, for some of us, when the waiting seems to stretch on a little longer than usual, what do you do in that season of waiting? And I want to take the life of Joseph and draw your attention to three amazing things that Joseph does in the seasons of waiting that he experienced and endured as well. The first thing that I would say Joseph did while he waited was Joseph worked on himself while he waited. I'll say it again. Joseph worked on himself while he waited. You know, sometimes when things fall apart in our life, we have a tendency to blame everyone around us. It's because of my parents I'm in this mess. It's because of my friends that these things have happened in my life. It's because of that relationship that this happened. We can sometimes put blame on others for the predicament that we find ourselves in life. And I find that a very good habit that we need to cultivate in our life, both in the good times and in the bad times, is what I would call self-examination or a self-evaluation. You know, it's something that we need to do in our life. Often, when things are going well, evaluate yourself to know, why are things going well? And when things are not going well, when things are all falling apart, then stop and evaluate again. What is the reason why nothing I'm doing is able to work out? You know, King David had this incredible habit, and the Bible makes a record of it in Psalm chapter 26, verse 2. And this was a prayer that David prayed several times in his life. And this is what David prayed. He says, "Put me on trial, O Lord. Cross-examine me. Test my motives and my heart." This was a prayer of David. He's saying, "God, put me on the table and cross-examine me. Evaluate me. Test me, test my heart, test my motives. I want you to tell me, are there things in my life that need to be changed? Are there things in my life that need to be corrected? Are there things in my life that needs to be further, you know, allowed to grow in my life as well?" Sometimes we want everyone around us to take responsibility for their mistakes. But do we take responsibility for where we find ourselves in today? Now, Joseph could have easily blamed his circumstances. You know, he could have said, "I did everything right, and yet everything has gone wrong. Life is just not fair." Joseph could have blamed his evil brothers. You know, he could have said, "I would not be here today if it weren't for those brothers of mine who threw me into a pit and mercilessly sold me to slavery." You know, we can either be ruled by our circumstances, or we can rule over our circumstances. Joseph went from being a highly favored son of his father to a dark pit, to a person's possession, and then to the royal prison. Joseph had every reason to blame people for his predicament, but he did not. Instead, you know what Joseph did? He decided to be the best he would be wherever he was going to be. I'll say that again. Joseph decided he was going to be the best he could be wherever he was. That meant that when he was a slave in Potiphar's home, he determined, "I'm going to be the best slave that Potiphar's ever seen." And that's exactly what happened. Because Potiphar lifted him up and promoted him from an obscure slave to becoming the right-hand man in Potiphar's home. Because Joseph made the decision, "I'm not going to wallow in self-pity. I'm not going to wallow in misery and blame everyone and everything in my life. I'm going to take responsibility for who I am and how I'm going to respond to my circumstances. I'm going to walk every day righteously. I'm going to walk every day with the joy of the Lord. I'm going to set an example for others to follow." And as Joseph decided to work on himself, God began to open doors for him. When Joseph was in prison, he did the exact same thing. You know, when he was put in prison, I don't know exactly what kind of responsibility Joseph would have been given in prison. You know, maybe it could have been digging ditches, or it could have been, you know, cutting onions for all the prisoners in the prison kitchen. It could have been just making up his room every day. Whatever the responsibility was given to Joseph, Joseph determined, "If I am in prison, I'm going to be the best prisoner Egypt has ever seen. I'm going to be the best model prisoner who will have the best attitude at all times, even if people mistreat me or ill-treat me. I'm going to respond to all of those moments of unfair things in my life with the best attitude." And guess what happened? The Bible again says, because of who Joseph was in prison, he was lifted up and given full command over the prison next to the warden. You know, someone once said, it said, "The grass isn't greener on the other side. It's greener wherever you water it." Now, a lot of times when we find ourselves stuck in a situation, we kind of long for what is to become or what it was, instead of being in that place that you find yourself in and saying, "I'm going to be the best that I can be where I am right now." You know, I would call it the bloom where I'm planted syndrome, meaning I'm going to thrive in the place that I find myself in, and I'm going to not let situations and circumstances dictate how I feel, dictate how I'm walking, dictate how my personality's changed. I'm going to stand strong and be the best that I can be no matter what the situation is. That's what Joseph did. He worked on himself. You know, it's so easy to tell others what they need to change and who they need to become. I find myself doing that sometimes in my life because it's easy to see the faults in others. It's easy to see what's wrong with everyone around you. But it's not so easy to tell yourself that you have shortcomings, that you could possibly be where you are because of the decisions you've taken. You know, maybe you are in the mess that you are in your finances, in your marriage, because of some decisions that you took. And instead of taking responsibility for those decisions and changing who you are, many of you are blaming every person in your family around you for where you are. And I tell you, if you want your situation to change, if you want to come out of this season that you're in, you got to begin working on yourself. You got to invite the Holy Spirit and say, Holy Spirit, help me today to be a better person. Help me today to have Christ-like character and nature. So the question that you need to ask yourself today is, what is God teaching me as I'm going through this situation? What is God saying to me as He's allowing this situation to prevail in my life? What is God saying to me as this job is being delayed? How can I better position myself to receive what God is about to release in my life? These are the questions that a child of God needs to ask themselves when they find themselves in unfair situations, in unjust circumstances. And instead of looking around to see who to blame, you look inward and you ask the question, Lord, examine my heart. Examine my motives. Is there anything within me that's not right, that's not pure? And if there is, please help me to change that situation. Help me to change that nature, that character. You know, the parable of the talents that we read in the Gospel of Matthew chapter 25, verse 21, the Bible says, you know, the master says to the servant, he says, well done, my good and faithful servant. You have been faithful in handling what was entrusted into your hands, so now I give you many more responsibilities. That's the reward that the master gives. See, in this parable, God changes the circumstance of the servant, rewarding him with a better job and high praise because he was faithful in what was already entrusted into his hands. And because he was faithful in what was already in his possession, and he did the best that he could do with what he had, God gave him more. That's the question you got to ask yourself today. Are you doing the best that you can do in the situation and in the moments of your life that you are in? Because God rewards us based on how we respond to the situations and circumstances that we find ourselves in our life. Don't say, oh, when this happens, then I'm going to do this. You know, when I get a job, I'm going to start tithing and I'm going to start giving to the Lord. Oh, when I get married, I will change this behavior, this habit of mine. Oh, when they come and ask my forgiveness, then I will do this for them. I tell you, do what you need to do now, and then God will do what He needs to do in your life tomorrow. A lot of us, we're always waiting for God to change our circumstances before we change ourselves. How about we change ourselves first and God begins to change our circumstances? And this is what Joseph began working in his life. He began, you know, allowing himself in the midst of unfair, unjust moments in his life to be the best that he could be in whatever situation he found himself. And while you're waiting for your husband, guard your heart and yourself and be the best single person that you could be. And while you're waiting for your boss to notice you and give you the promotion that you deserve, why don't you continue being a faithful employee and stop moaning and complaining about how you deserve that promotion more than others? And while you're waiting to complete your education, be diligent in the things that have been given to you right now in pursuing your education. And as you're doing what you need to be doing at this moment faithfully, then God begins doing what he needs to do tomorrow in setting you up for your victory as well. Joseph began working on himself while he waited for the season to change. Here's the second thing Joseph did. Joseph waited on others while he waited. I'll say it again. Joseph waited on others while he waited. You know, obviously, Joseph wasn't the only one in prison. There were several other prisoners. The Bible says that after some time, Pharaoh's official cupbearer and chief baker found themselves in prison as well. We don't know the reason for why they were in prison, but the Bible just says they were in prison. In Genesis chapter 40, verse 4 onwards, this is what the Bible says. They remained in prison for quite some time. And the captain of the guard assigned them to Joseph, who looked after them while they were in prison. Pharaoh's cupbearer and baker each had a dream one night, and each dream had its own meaning. When Joseph saw them the next morning, he noticed that both of them looked upset. He noticed. "Why do you look so worried?" he asked them. Now, this might go without saying, but whatever you're going through, you're not the first person to go through what you're going through. I'll say it again. Whatever you're going through, you're not the first person who's going through what you're going through. There are thousands, if not millions, of people who are facing a financial debt and a situation in their life right now, just like you. There are several people who are listening to me right now who are unhappy, dissatisfied with their job. Not just you. There are many, many thousands of people struggling. There are many, many thousands of people who are waiting with bated breath to find their life partner just like you are. You know, sometimes we kind of have this pity party where we think we're the only person who endures this injustice. We're the only person who goes through all this pain and misery. And I want to tell you this morning, to burst your bubble a little bit, you're not the only one. How does that make you feel? You're not the only one who's going through what you're going through. There are so many others who are going through it. And Joseph was in prison for a crime he didn't commit. But instead of wallowing in self-pity, he looked after other prisoners who were there. Isn't that amazing? Here he is, unjustly put in prison, and he could have just locked himself in his cell and said, "I don't want to ever see another face again for the rest of my life or the rest of my time here in prison." He could have stayed in his cell, but no, he walked out and says, "Hey, while I'm here, I'm going to make sure others are happy. While I'm here, I'm just going to make sure others, you know, have enough to eat and enough to drink, and they're not worried, they look happy." Joseph began to care for others. When they seemed upset, he genuinely shows concern for their situation. Now think about this. Who better to care for a prisoner than a fellow prisoner? Let me make it a little bit closer to home. Who better to encourage a person in debt than a person who is in debt? Who better to encourage a single person who is waiting to get married than a single person who themselves are waiting to get married? Who better to encourage someone who is jobless than the person who themselves are jobless in telling them, "It's okay. Have faith, trust in God, it's going to be okay, God's going to change your situation"? I think this is a great habit that a Christian needs to cultivate in their life. You know, Joseph exemplified this amazing ability to be outward looking instead of inward looking. You know, I read this interesting story of how a 15-year-old boy named Doug, he was diagnosed with leukemia. He was treated at one of the best hospitals in the country, and the doctors kind of told him in blunt terms about his disease, and they said to him, "You know, for the next 3 years, you have to come in for chemotherapy. You know, we're not going to sugarcoat, you know, the treatment or the side effects. You're going to go bald. You're going to feel miserable. You know, it's not going to be an easy journey." You know, when he heard all these things that the doctor told him, this kid, Doug, went into depression. He just kind of lost hope and did not want to live anymore. And many of his family members kind of rallied around him, trying to encourage him and tell him, it's okay, you're going to do okay, you're going to survive this, you're going to make it through. And he just did not respond to any encouragement from anyone. One day, Doug's aunt called a floral shop to try to send Doug some flowers in the hospital to cheer him up. So she called up this florist and told the florist a little bit about what she was doing and said to her, you know, my nephew is in the hospital with leukemia, so I just want to send some flowers to cheer him up. So she kind of dictated what was to be written in the card and had the flowers sent. So the next day, Doug receives this beautiful bouquet of flowers in his hospital room. He receives it and sees a card from his aunt, sweet words encouraging him. And then suddenly he finds another card attached to the back of the bouquet. And he pulls that card and then he begins to read. And the card says, Douglas, I work at the Bricks Florist. You know, and I took your order and I heard from your aunt what you're going through. And I just want to tell you, when I was 7 years old, I was diagnosed with leukemia. And it was a really difficult journey, but I made it through and I'm totally well today. And I just want to tell you, you're also going to make it through and everything's going to be okay with you as well. The moment Doug read that card, his face lit up. Here he was in the best hospital in the country, surrounded by most esteemed doctors, and none of that mattered. What really helped Doug was hearing a word of encouragement from someone else who had been through what he was going to go through. I tell you, there's something amazing about people encouraging one another in the midst of their difficult situation as well. That's what the Bible says. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 3 and 4, the Bible says, God is our merciful Father and the source of all comfort. He comforts us in all troubles so we can comfort others. When they are troubled, we will be able to give them the same comfort God has given us. You know, I want to tell you this morning, don't wallow in self-pity in your situation, whatever you find yourself in. Don't allow the devil to beat you down and make you think that you're the only person in this entire universe who is going through what you're going through. You're not. There are many others who are suffering. There are many others who are in even greater predicaments than you are. And yet, could it be that God expects of you as his son, as his daughter, to begin to speak words of encouragement to others in the midst of your difficulty to encourage others? Now that's what the Bible says. He who waters others will himself be watered. Meaning when you choose to encourage other people when you're down, in the process of doing that, you will find your encouragement. You'll find your hope and your strength as well. Joseph, you know, never read 2 Corinthians 1, 3, and 4. But yet he lived it out in his life. Every day when he woke up in prison, he probably got up and said, who am I going to put a smile on today? You know, I just want to make people happy. I just want to make people, you know, content. If they're in prison, I just want to tell them it's all going to be over soon. You know, they're going to get out of here. Things are going to change and God's going to do something amazing. And Joseph just was so encouraging to people that he caught the attention of those who came into prison. I want to tell you this morning, God wants to use your pain to bring encouragement to other people as well. Ask the Holy Spirit this morning, Holy Spirit, give me the maturity to become outward focused rather than inward focused. I don't want to just, you know, throw a pity party for myself and complain and whine and moan about how everything is not going right for me. Rather, I want to tell other people that God is in control. He's going to change their life. He's going to change their situation, to hold on to hope and to tell them everything is going to be okay. And as you begin doing that, when you wait on others, as you're waiting, God begins to do something amazing in your life as well. The third thing that Joseph does in the season of waiting is Joseph waited on God as he waited. Yeah, I'll say it again. Joseph waited on God as he waited. The cupbearer and the baker, you know, tell Joseph one morning, because they were so unsettled, Joseph asks them, what's wrong? And they say, we've had a bad dream. And Joseph says in, in Genesis chapter 40, verse 8, and I kind of highlighted that statement last week, and Joseph says, interpreting dreams is God's business, you know? What an incredible attitude to have. You know, someone who is actually scorned and put in prison as a result of the original dream that he had as a 17-year-old, he still, you know, says dreams are from God. God interprets dreams, and he has such a positive way he looks at life. And through it all, Joseph never lost his trust in God. Through it all, Joseph never let himself to get bitter with God as well. After giving credit to where credit was due, Joseph, you know, explains to each of the inmate the meaning of their dream. You know, he gave the bad news to the baker and the good news to the cupbearer. He says, in 3 days' time, you know, the chief baker, you're going to be impaled, you know, on a pole and left for dead. And then he looks at the cupbearer and says, in 3 days' time, you're going to be released from prison and restored to your original position of being a cupbearer to the king. 3 days later, Pharaoh's birthday comes about, and every single word that Joseph said comes to pass. You know, exactly the way Joseph explained things would happen, it happens. Think about this for a moment. Imagine with me the scene at the prison cell that morning. You know, there's shouts of joy one way, and there's, you know, crying and weeping on the other side. But I'm sure Joseph kind of headed towards the guy who was headed out rather than headed up, you know. Joseph goes to the cupbearer, you know, and the cupbearer probably is just, you know, thrilled and excited and just besides himself with joy. And he thanks Joseph, you know, as he's about to head out the prison door. And then Joseph, just as he's about to step out of prison, grabs his hand, and then Joseph says to him these words in Genesis chapter 40, verse 14. Joseph says to him, hey, please remember me. Do me a favor when things go well for you. Mention me to Pharaoh so that he may let me out of this place, for I was kidnapped from my homeland, the land of the Hebrews, and now I am here in prison. But I did nothing to deserve it. Now, the Bible doesn't record the response of the cupbearer, but I can just picture and imagine it. Cupbearer who's so excited and enthused about leaving prison. Like, ah, Joseph, for you, anything, Joseph. You're my man. I'm going to make sure the first word that's out of my lips as soon as I get out of here is Joseph, 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 Joseph. Pharaoh's going to hear about you, hear about the tremendous work that you're doing in prison, and just, you know, it's all going to be ready, Joseph. You know, just get ready. Walks out the prison door. You know, and Joseph probably ran back to his cell, you know, packs up his bag, you know, takes up all his belongings and puts it together. He's like, today's my day of deliverance. You know, I'm about to walk out of this prison. Finally, things are going to start looking well for me. Joseph sits there, you know, says to the guys, guys, I'm leaving, you know. And they're all signing him a farewell card and telling him, Joseph, you're such a great guy. We're going to miss you. You know, we've really enjoyed having you around. And all of these, you know, farewells are happening in prison, and Joseph is gearing up and getting ready. And I don't know if he shaved and put on his best clothes because he knew he was about to come out of prison. Nothing happens that day. Joseph thinks, well, you know, this is all political stuff. It's going to take a little time, bureaucracy and red tape, you know. The Pharaoh has to say it to the guard, and the guard has to say it to this guy. It's kind of missed somewhere. I'm going to wait for tomorrow. Wakes up the next day with just as much expectation. Nothing happens. Third day, fourth day, a week goes by, month goes by, 6 months go by, a year goes by. Nothing happens. 2 years go by, and nothing happens in Joseph's life. Think about it for a moment. 2 years. That's 730 nights. And that's 11,680 waking hours where Joseph sat suspended, where nothing happened the way he thought would happen. You know, the Bible tells us what Joseph did not know, you know, in Genesis chapter 40, verse 23. And I'm going to read the Message translation. This is what the Bible says. It says, the head cupbearer never gave Joseph another thought. He forgot all about him. How do you deal with such setbacks? How do you deal with such incredible disappointment. When you think you're about to have your victory, when you think you're about to be delivered, and yet to go back to square one, where you're again rotting away in obscurity, how do you deal with that? I'll tell you, Joseph stands as an amazing example for you and me. You know, he just continued being faithful, continued doing what he did. And I'm sure he would have experienced disappointment just like you and I do, but he didn't allow the disappointment to overcome him. He overcame disappointment and continued being faithful. Bible says after 2 years, you know, it's so wonderful how God orchestrates things. God gives Pharaoh a dream. And Pharaoh wakes up all disturbed from his dream, and that's when, you know, the hard knucklehead, you know, the cupbearer, realizes that he had forgotten all about Joseph. And immediately he tells Pharaoh about this guy in prison who has this uncanny ability to interpret dreams with such accuracy. Pharaoh says, fetch him at once. So then Joseph is immediately prepared and brought out of prison. And here's the interesting thing. The first words that you hear from Joseph's mouth after 2 years of being in disappointment, living in disappointment, the Bible makes record of the first words that come out of Joseph's mouth. This is what it says in Genesis chapter 41, verse 16. These are the first recorded words of Joseph. He says, I can't, but God can. Give Pharaoh the answer that he needs. I'll draw your attention to that phrase again. I can't, but God can. And that's a word that I want to leave for you this morning. No matter what you're dealing with, however long you've been waiting for your situation, those words are still as true today as they were the day that Joseph uttered it. You may be jobless, spouseless, futureless, houseless, hopeless, but don't ever forget that you have a God who can. You have a God who can give you the best job. You have a God who can give you the best spouse. You have a God who can give you all that you need and supply all your needs according to His riches and glory. You have a God who can deliver you. You have a God who can give justice and peace to your life like no one else can. No matter what your situation is, this is the hope that you and I hold on to. I can't, but God can. I can't change my circumstance, but God can. I can't do anything about where I am, but God can. And I'm going to hold on to that hope. I'm going to hold on to that promise that God is faithful and God will do what He said He will do in my life as well. And as you wait on Him, as you continue to hold on to His promises, I tell you, God will do an amazing work in your life. You just tell yourself, you know, I may not have the strength. I may not have the ability. I may not know the right people. I may not have the influence. I may not have enough money to get me out of this trouble, but I have a God who can. My God knows the people that need to get me out of this. My God has the best connection that anyone can have. My God has all the resources that anyone can have to get me out of my situation. And I'm going to put my trust in God, not in myself, not in people, not in situation, but in my God. That's what Joseph did. In those years of incredible disappointment, he continued to wait on God. Wait on God's timing. Now, I came across some interesting facts about this tree called the Chinese bamboo tree. Apparently, the Chinese plant the seed, the bamboo tree seed, and they fertilize it and water it. The whole first year, nothing happens. And then the second year, they do the same. They continue watering it, fertilizing it. Nothing happens. Third year, fourth year, they continue to tend for the seed, but nothing happens. Then in the fifth year, somewhere along the course of the fifth year, suddenly that seed sprouts. And in just a matter of few weeks, that seed goes from being a seed to a 90-foot high bamboo tree. And that's what's crazy about this Chinese bamboo tree. At the way it grows after such a long time and how quickly it can grow as well. So the natural question that you and I can ask is, did it grow 90 feet in that few weeks of growth, or did it grow 90 feet in the 5 years that it stayed as a seed? And I would tell you, the answer is, I think, that it grew the 90 feet over the course of the 5 years. You know, the growth that we saw on the external was all actually happening on the inside as well. There's something happening inside that was preparing the seed for this sudden accelerated growth as well. Some of the most amazing growth can happen on the inside. In your life as well, some of the most amazing growth can happen on the inside, where no one can see it. You look at the life of Joseph and you think, 10 years in Potiphar's house, several years in prison. You may think Joseph is rotting away, and yet Joseph, while he was in prison and while he was in Potiphar's house, was only getting stronger and bigger every single day. So when the time came when God was ready to begin a work in the life of Joseph, Joseph had already done all the growing that needed to be done to be ready to be used by God. Why don't you use this time of waiting to grow in God, to grow in your character, to grow in your integrity and faithfulness? Don't let this time pass you by where, you know, you're just frustrated and disappointed and just, you know, discouraged all the time. Instead, wait on God. Grow in your love for Jesus. Grow in your knowledge of God. Grow in your character. And as you begin applying yourself on the inside, the time will come when God opens that door, when God brings you to that opportunity. And then you will be ready with everything that you need to go through and be the person that God wants you to be as well. You know, as Joseph waited, three things that he did in the season of waiting. Joseph worked on himself, meaning we need to learn to be the best that we can be no matter what the situation is. Secondly, Joseph waited on others while he waited. For you and me, that means be an encourager. Be an encouragement to others, even in your season of difficulty as well. And thirdly, Joseph waited on God as he waited. Meaning, keep growing in God as you are waiting. Because soon the season of waiting will end. Soon the day will break. The sun will rise. The season of mourning will stop. And the season of dancing will begin. And it matters what you do in those seasons of mourning and in the season of difficulty, because that will make you who you will be when your deliverance comes. When the time came for Joseph, when the deliverance came for him, Joseph had already built his character, who he was, to be ready to be used by God when his time came. I want to encourage you today, no matter what it is, no matter what the circumstance is in your life, God has not forgotten you. God has not given up on you. He is actually using your situation and your circumstance to do something amazing in your life. I want to pray with you today. Pray that today you will commit yourself to grow in your life, to change the things that need to be changed, that you will make that prayer that David prayed in Psalm 26, saying, God, examine me, examine my heart, check my motives, check my intentions, and help me to be pure in how I live my life. Maybe you can begin making that prayer today. Lord, I put myself on the altar. And Lord, work in my life. Work in the areas that need to be worked. And help me to be a better husband, a better wife, a better father, a better mother, a better single person. Lord, whatever it is, a better employee. Help me where I am to be the best that I can be in reflecting your nature and your character as well. And as you're waiting, look around to see who you could be a blessing to, who you could encourage, and tell them that it's going to be okay. In the midst of your disappointment, turn someone else's disappointment into great hope for their life. And as you do that, God will help encourage you and strengthen you. And don't forget Isaiah 40:31, those who wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. So will you wait on the Lord? You're going to get stronger. You're going to get bigger. Waiting time is not wasted time in the kingdom of God. Those are some of the most precious seasons in our life where God does some of the deepest works in us to prepare us for what He wants to do in our life. So today I want to pray for those of you especially who find yourself in that season of waiting. Today that you will be strengthened and encouraged, knowing that God is with you and for you. Would you join me in prayer here today? And also especially for anyone who's listening today who may not know Jesus Christ, who's never experienced the gift of salvation. The Bible says, to anyone who calls upon the name of Jesus, God gives to them forgiveness and salvation. And that's as simple and as easy as it can be for every single person, regardless of their religious affiliation or background. You can experience the salvation of Jesus Christ today. You just need to ask Him. He'll forgive you, give you a brand new start, and begin to bless your life and build your life as well. Pray with me here today. Heavenly Father, Lord, I've shared with your people here today on the amazing journey in the life of Joseph and how we can learn these three precious truths in the season of waiting, Lord. I pray for those who find themselves suspended in that season of waiting at this time in their life, where they're frustrated, where they're discouraged, where they're disappointed, where they feel great injustice has been done to them. I pray in all of those moments of discouragement today, they will receive hope and encouragement. That God, you are with them, and you will work all things together for good for those who love you and are called according to your purpose, Lord. Pray you will strengthen your people, encourage them and strengthen them. And I pray as they begin to look inward and work in their life and begin to allow the Holy Spirit to build their character, I pray they will begin to come into a new season in their life, Lord. I pray for those who may not know you, Jesus, may not have ever experienced the gift of salvation. This morning, I thank you that as they call upon your name, you are faithful to forgive them and faithful to forgive all their sins and to give them a new beginning and a new start in their life. We speak your blessing upon them. We pray that the blessing of the favor of God will rest upon your people. In this month of August, let your children witness and see great things done in their life on behalf of their life as well. Bless everyone who's listening today. In the precious name of Jesus, we pray. And everyone said, amen, amen, amen. God richly bless you. We're so glad that you're with us. And I pray that you'll have a blessed, God-filled week this week. God bless you.